Welcome. Today we will explore the ways in which global corporations and public actors have co-created our built environment and our lifestyles around petroleum in its multiple forms over the last 150 years. We will look at oil as an actor of urban, socioeconomic and cultural change through the lens of the Randstad, the Netherlands. To project sustainable cities of the future, we have to take into account both the cities that we have, some of which have evolved over thousands of years, and the cultures of the people who live in these cities, to facilitate the implementation of new technologies and energy policies, we also need to inspire new mindsets. That includes helping people understand how things are now. This map of 2014 shows how the flows of oil and money connect producers and consumers around the world. Effectively linking the highways in the US or Europe to new iconic buildings in the Middle East. These images help citizens read oil's commodity and financial flows through built form. As we trace the history of oil's impact on cities, we find planned intervention, perhaps best illustrated by the City of the Future project for the 1939 World's Fair in New York. Sponsored by General Motors and imagined by Norman Bel Geddes, this vision was used for advertisement purposes by Shell. It went on to inspire urban form in the second part of the 20th century. Public planning has created many urban areas and set the conditions for economic development. But private actors and the commodity flows associated with them have also driven unplanned urban change, such as suburban sprawl that developed with the growing use of the car. The extraordinary reach of corporations into political and economic institutions is well captured in this 1904 cartoon illustrating Standard Oil's reach for the steel, copper, and shipping industries, as well as a state house, the US Capitol, and the White House. The global corporations of the oil industry, here in blue, with the support of public actors, in red, have utterly transformed the built environment. They have constructed landscapes, urban forms and functions, as well as buildings of various scales, types and aesthetics. In short, architectural and urban expressions of the network of oil. The same corporations that have changed the built environment have also influenced how we conceive of, use and design it. In turn, these imaginary scapes influence architects, artists, writers and the general public, here in yellow, as they produce buildings and artistic works, but also films, literature or everyday language that represent the built environment. I employ the notion of petroleumscape to capture these flows and spaces and their specific scopes and forms, both physical and mental. This flowchart shows a first tentative and certainly not final illustration of the complex ways in which global corporations, in collaboration with numerous actors, such as governments, architects, engineers, designers, planners, artists, oil subcontractors and other oil-related industries, but also citizens, have shaped urban form. I argue that we need a thorough understanding of these intersections as we aim to build future sustainable cities, and that changing the imaginaries is an important step in creating fossil-free energy landscapes. First, I will discuss the development of the physical petroleumscapes. These physical landscapes have developed, intersected, and reinforced each other. Then I will explore the ways in which oil companies have imagined the physical landscapes for their customers, developing mental petroleumscapes. Let us now see what this approach to petroleumscapes means concretely for our area here in the Netherlands. This ARA, Amsterdam, Rotterdam, and Antwerp spot market area is particularly worthwhile studying as it includes the second largest petrochemical complex after Houston. We will specifically explore how oil has contributed to the construction and design of the Randstad, this densely built metropolitan area in the west of the Netherlands. Here we focus specifically on the Rotterdam, The Hague region, providing one example of the interlinking petroleum scapes that are similar to those in other petroleum-based urban regions all around the world. The first petroleum scape is the industrial footprint of oil, its storage, transformation, and transportation. It is highly functional, almost identical around the globe, huge in both size and investment, and at the core of the oil business. The growth of the Rotterdam port from 1862 to today is captured here in preliminary analytical drawings. These images illustrate the impact that the physical flows of oil have had on urban form. The first of these industrial facilities were built for lighting oil. They have grown enormously over the last 100 years and now take up a lot of space in the Rotterdam port, with storage tanks, refineries, pipelines, and other infrastructure spanning from the inner city to the tip of the port, the Maasvlakte 2, here in 1972. Oil-related structures are a major part of the 5,300 hectares of industrial space in the Rotterdam port, with storage tanks, refineries, and pipelines. This petroleum scape is largely inaccessible and rarely considered conceptually by built environment scholars or citizens. Parallel to the industrial petroleum scape is a distribution one, a retail network of gas stations. These structures have evolved along with cars, road infrastructure, and user needs since the beginning of the 20th century. The Dutch retail landscape has unique features. Faced with opposition from a citizen organization in 1939, the companies established a distinctively Dutch appearance through the works of leading architects, including Sybold van Ravestein, with the gas station here, or Willem M. Dudok. Gas stations are now ubiquitous in our cities and rural areas. They can take on a regional flavor, adapting to local urban forms or changing consumer preferences. Today, they boast unified names and colors of oil companies. Compared to the stable and fixed industrial oil landscape, the gas stations form a more fleeting and flexible landscape. But as places of regular contact with citizen consumers and everywhere across the countryside, they make a strong impact on people's minds. The Randstad is also home to headquarters and research centers, establishing yet another face of the oil industry, a petroleum scape of administration. Companies translate the physical presence of oil administration and research facilities into more distinctive urban and architectural spaces. The large administrative and research facilities of Royal Dutch Shell in The Hague, the former Esso headquarters, or the BIM, Bataafse Importmaatschappij, are in prestigious location in The Hague. Or here, the Shell headquarters in Rotterdam. A fourth auxiliary petroleum scape is more typical in other parts of the world. For example, Abadan in Iran, built by the Anglo-Iranian oil company, now BP, from the 1920s to the 1950s. It consists of company-built facilities, housing, leisure, educational, or religious institutions, as well as company investments into public infrastructures of diverse types. These industrial, retail, and administrative networks have grown in the Randstad, also co-shaping numerous auxiliary structures, housing, schools, or other cultural institutions that we have only started to identify. Furthermore, the spread of petroleum structures went hand in hand with the growth of public rail, road, and pipeline infrastructure. So, to summarize, the industrial, retail, and administrative, as well as auxiliary networks, have grown in the Randstad in close conjunction with railroad and pipeline infrastructure, as shown in these maps, combining all three petroleum scapes. actually all four petroleumscapes. From 1910, when oil was used mostly for lighting, more people started to use cars, to 1970, when extensive port areas were dedicated to oil and highways with associated gas stations that captured the rural areas, to 2000, when oil had become a prominent part of everyday urban and rural areas. Its presence today generates multiple additional streams of finances, people's ideas, and imaginaries, all of which merit further exploration. The impact of oil on the Randstad is not limited to these physical petroleumscapes. They intersect with mental ones. The oil companies generate these imagined landscapes for the general public. They are very different from the ones that they physically built and from people's experiences or conceptions of those industrial spaces. And they change how we conceive of and use our environment. Whereas my research seeks to connect domains, corporations have carefully separated the petroleumscapes that they physically built from people's experiences or conceptions of those industrial spaces. These representations are not neutral. They actually change the ways how we conceive of and use our environment. They use a variety of tools to construct these. The first is corporate media. Since the 1930s, oil companies have used maps to fuel the general public's desire to explore the Dutch landscape. They promote the car as a vehicle of freedom and discovery, pun intended. The covers of maps, brochures, and booklets produced by oil companies rarely depict refineries or headquarters. Instead, the company colors and logos show traditional landscapes, tourist destinations, or historical, scientific, or cultural explorations. Often themes of the advertisements echo societal changes and preferences, ranging from the quality of fuel in the 1950s to issues of gender in the 1980s and environmental themes today. Looking beyond companies and consumers, we can see that independent players also create imaginaries of oil culture. By including references to oil aesthetics in public or private buildings and in urban designs. Architectural adaptations of refinery aesthetics are evident in the well-known Centre Pompidou in Paris, or the public library in Rotterdam by Jaak Bakema, pictured here. Artists have similarly reacted to the changing landscape with representations of gas stations, such as by Xaver Sakwici, or by Raoun Gordain. Petroleum is also part of our popular culture. Just think of children's toys that promote the recognition of oil buildings, logos, and colors from an early age on. And many other aspects of oil culture, such as media and citizen responses, remain to be explored. As we imagine cities beyond oil, numerous questions arise about future technologies, policies, and lifestyles. But many of these developments will take place in existing cities. As we invent the future, we thus have to think about the ways in which our physical structures and mindsets have been co-shaped by petroleum and how this influences contemporary design. We must acknowledge the persistence of these mindscapes and take them into account when we clean up and redevelop polluted areas, when we develop new buildings, neighborhoods, or forms of mobility, or when we preserve and represent the remnants of oil modernity. Petroleum has polluted the ground for decades, and sometimes even longer, often poisoning neighboring housing districts. As refineries and storage areas around the world disappear, they will require extensive and specialized cleanup. For how much longer will oil occupy large part of the Rotterdam port? And what will we do when it leaves? We also need to consider themes of preservation and heritage. As petroleum becomes a part of our past, how will we remember and preserve the networked, heavily polluted industrial heritage of oil, the storage tanks, pipelines, and the drilling platforms? Some spaces, such as gas stations, are small and relatively easy to scrap and, after appropriate cleanup of the soil, also easy to replace. But what will we do with the highways that are the paradigms of the car age? Indeed, once petroleum is in our past, how will we explain oil-related structures such as the headquarters or gas stations that are part of our architectural and cultural heritage, even already added to the National Heritage List? How shall we analytically frame transformations such as the renovation of the Adam Tower, the former Toren Overhooks, designed by Arthur Stahl for Shell in 1967, and that now has become an urban icon in the heart of Amsterdam? Addressing the tangible and intangible heritage of oil in the city and in the landscape is a key challenge, including, for example, on how to think beyond petromobility. If mindscapes influence how people generate new physical petroleum scapes, then recognizing them and, furthermore, transforming them is perhaps the first step in creating fossil-free energy landscapes. Building on the research laid out above, many questions still remain to be explored: intermediary responses, citizen experiences, or popular languages. Happily, we can turn to new technologies to help with this. An augmented reality tool and an open source website are already under development at TU Delft. These tools are for you to track the history, location, and spread of petroleumscapes, to collect narratives of oil, to understand their role in the popular imaginary, to challenge them and to contribute to the imagining and promotion of alternative energy futures.